This is Red Ice Radio. From the visible to the obscure. RedIceCreations.com.
Yes, that's correct. Red Ice Radio is what you are listening to. RedIceCreations.com is our website, and we're delighted to have you with us today. My name is Henrik Palmgren, and if you have been following our website for the last year or more, you know that we put focus on many of the earth changes and space anomalies that have been reported by the media, the alternative press, and individuals on their own blogs, websites, and YouTube channels. Obviously, there's so much that it's practically impossible to keep up with it all, but some of the major stories have been about magnetic north now being on the move. Strange spirals have been appearing over Norway, Australia, Mongolia, New Zealand, and Russia. There have been birds falling out of the sky around the world, heralding some kind of apocalypse. A mirage city mysteriously appeared in China in June. A portal-like light burst bubble or whatever it was seen over Hawaii. And the sun rose 2 days early for our friends up in Greenland. There have been strange plasma light phenomena in Fort Worth, Texas, and many other places as well. Low rumbles and hums are reported. There are also people saying that the sunrise and sunset has shifted, that it's setting more towards the north, and that the quality of the light is different, and some people even claim that the stars are displaced, and the moon is consequently also behaving strangely. And then we have the usual strangeness continuing as well, increased amounts of earthquakes, strange weather patterns, sinkholes have opened up in different places around the globe, and strange bright lights are being reported around the world. And while some of these strange phenomena might be a consequence of technology or experimentation, I don't think it explains everything. And the suggestion is, of course, that something else is going on, and the question is what? Maybe we're making a mistake when we're connecting all of these different phenomena, but they are nonetheless all contributing to the sense of strangeness that something is going on. And who knows, maybe the strangeness just has begun. John Lash is back with us on the program today to talk about Sophia's correction and what might be the reason then for many of these anomalies. John Lash is a self-educated freelance scholar who combines studies and experimental mysticism to teach directive mythology, that is, the application of myth to life, rather than its mere interpretation. He is a leading exponent of the power of myth to direct individual experience and drive historical events over the long term. He's an expert on sidereal mythology, naked eye astronomy, precession, and the world ages. He also teaches the critique of belief systems. And on metahistory.org, his website, he presents a radical revision of Gnosticism with original commentaries on the Nag Hammadi codices. He also presents the only complete restoration by any scholar of the Sophianic myth of the pagan mysteries, the sacred story of Gaia Sophia, recounting the origin of the Earth and the human species from the galactic core. Stay with us for the next 2 hours for a very intriguing discussion. Welcome back to Red Ice Radio, John Lash. It is great to have you back with us again. It's over a year ago since we talked with you last, and so many things have unfolded, obviously. So many things have happened, and we have a lineup of interesting things we're going to talk with you about here. But first of all, then, John, welcome back. How are you today?
I'm very fine, Henry. Thank you so much for having me on again. It's a pleasure and a privilege.
Absolutely. It's really good to talk to you. And I wanted to have you back because primarily I got an email from you a few days ago, maybe a week ago now, in terms of something that you termed Sophia's correction. You included a video in the email, and one who took the time to watch it could obviously see some pretty interesting things in regards to, basically spanning from the Western media covering this aspect of the shifting of the magnetic north all the way over to the Inuits of the northern parts on around the Arctic regions, talking about primarily the setting and the rising sun, the shifts and the changes that has happened in that. And this is a big topic, obviously. This is a very interesting one. If we go back a little bit more into the news record, so to speak, John, we could bring up this news item from Greenland as well. People might recall stories coming out from Greenland that the sun was actually rising 2 days early. And a lot of these different little anomalies connected with the sun, connected with the magnetic field, seems to be kind of, piling up, if you will, John. What is your take on this? Tell us a little bit about this, Sophia's correction.
Well, Sophia's correction is a term taken from the Gnostic writings of Nag Hammadi. It's found in those texts. It's a theme or clue, you might say, that was left to us by the Telestai, who were the ancient seers who directed the mystery schools and the ancient schools of initiation in Europe and the pagan world. And it's a very intriguing clue, Sophia's connection, for a number of reasons. First of all, because the myth of Sophia, the story of the goddess Sophia, that was the centerpiece and guiding vision of the mysteries, is really the only true planetary myth that we have that explains the origin of the Earth and the origin of humanity, and also explains as well the presence of predatory extraterrestrial beings in our world. It explains a great many things. Now, I recovered and restored this myth from my study of the Gnostic materials. I want to point out going in that this myth is not my creation. It's not the invention of John Lash, not by a long shot. But I am the only scholar who has completely restored this myth, which I consider to be the directing myth for the human species. And the Gnostics themselves and the ancient seers who developed it also considered it as such. Now, one of the interesting things about this myth, and of course, understand that I mean myth in this sense as a story of power and magic and a true story presented in a poetic or metaphorical form. I mean myth in the sense of a deeper truth, not in the sense of a fiction or fabrication. I think everyone listening would understand that. Beautiful thing about this myth, Henrik, is that it's an open-ended myth. Now, when you take other myths from any culture, like the myth of Ragnarok, of the Götterdämmerung, or the end of the world myths from Teutonic or Scandinavian mythology, or when you take the biblical myth of creation and the coming of the Messiah and the end of the world, all the myths that you can examine that have come down to us have a prescripted end. But this story about the divine Sophia, who is the earth goddess and is, in fact, the embodied in the earth, doesn't have an end. It's an open-ended experiment. The myth is an invitation to become involved in a cosmic and supernatural dimension of life and to be conscious agents and participants in the future of the earth itself. This is a tremendous, tremendous concept. And this is where Sophia's correction comes in. Sophia's correction, the word correction, is found in the Nag Hammadi text as the word diorthosis, D-I-O-R-T-H-O-S-I-S, which scholars translate as correction. But it can also be translated as dual solution or two-form solution. It means the solution or the correction to a problem. And so what is the problem that is described in this Sophianic myth that is due to be corrected? Well, the problem is that the goddess Sophia, as the myth tells us, conceived that there could be a divine experiment with humanity, with our species. And she had a particular idea of how this experiment would go. And the way that we are living now, the place that we find ourselves on Earth currently, is a place in which this divine experiment has gone badly wrong. In other words, I think that even without extensive argument, any person with a kind of common sense and also a feeling of compassion for other human beings would understand that something is very wrong in the way we're living on this planet. Something is very wrong about where civilization has taken us. Something very wrong about the way we do business and the way we treat each other. And the tremendous degree of secrecy and manipulation that permeates our world something is real, is telling us that something is really, really wrong here. And the beautiful, one of the beautiful aspects of the Sophianic myth is that it addresses this situation. And Sophia's correction is actually the solution to this situation. But I would add, and I'm very happy that you've chosen that as the theme and title for this interview, because we're going to weave in and out of this theme. This is our master theme. This is our guiding theme. And I just want to say at the outset that the beautiful thing about the correction that humanity can now achieve is that it is a cooperative correction made with the Earth Goddess. It's not something that we as human beings just do on our own. We finally straighten out, figure out what's wrong, figure out where all the secrecy and deception are coming from, and clear things up. Certainly, that's possible. But the beautiful part of the Sophianic myth is it offers us the opportunity to clean up our act and bring humanity back into the true path of our divine experiment with the Earth Goddess in actual interactivity and communication with her. And I call that interactivity with Gaia, Gaia Sophia, planetary tantra. It's just the name that I put on the practice of that interactivity and communication. And we stand now, as a species, on the threshold of planetary tantra.
How so? Why now? What are the properties of this, John?
There are two particular reasons why planetary tantra would be happening now and would be possible now. Three particular factors, actually. One of them is that we are coming to the end of a great cosmic cycle, which is the cycle of the precession of the zodiac. Sure, you know what that is. Many of your speakers and interview people have talked about it.
That's right.
According to my calculation, which is based on the Dendera Zodiac in correlation with other Maya, Aztec, and Hindu chronologies, the great cosmic clock of the zodiac, the great precessional cycle, ends in 2216. I choose that date because that's the date when the winter solstice aligns with the point toward the galactic center. The location of the winter solstice is currently about 2 to 3 degrees offline from the galactic center. When the winter solstice aligns exactly with the galactic center, that is the zero hour on the cosmic clock as it was calculated in ancient times. And so it becomes possible at the very, in the last 200 years of this vast cycle of 26,000 years to make a tremendous leap in amplification in human experience and to actually recapitulate our past, see the errors of the past, jump beyond those errors and move into a period of rapid amplification and acceleration of human consciousness in these last 200 years, which are called technically Kali Yuga.
So John, this is, sorry to interrupt, but I want to ask you here.
Sure.
That means that this is connected then, in other words, to something physical, a cosmic alignment being the matter of our solar system, if you will, lining up with the center of the galaxy, correct?
This opportunity for planetary tantra today, right now, and this opportunity for interactive magic with the planetary goddess is deeply physical. It is deeply physical in many ways. We're going to get into that through this conversation. I hope to be able to elucidate it for you. These anomalies that we're seeing are indications of the physical breakthrough into interactivity with Sophia. And so it's happening, first of all, I said there were three factors. One of them is that it's happening within a cosmic time frame. And the cosmic time frame doesn't guarantee that anything is going to happen. But in the last age, in the last years of Kali Yuga, an ancient teaching says that in the last centuries of Kali Yuga, when we are living now, that is the time when humanity as a whole reaches its worst state of degeneration, absurdity, stupidity, violence, and oblivion.
And we sure can see it, John,
and
when we look around.
And we sure are there. At the same time, because there's a double message about Kali Yuga. Mm. The other thing that the Mahanavana Tantra says is that even though the great mass of humanity descends into degeneration, this is the time for the highest opportunity for spiritual development in the shortest period of time. Mm. And so this amplification, this opportunity for very rapid, fast-track spiritual development and fast-track acquisition of shamanic and magical powers by our species uniquely occurs in this timing. That's one reason as far as the cosmic time frame is concerned. So now let me see if I can give you very briefly what the other two reasons are. Mm-hmm. The other two reasons why it's happening now is, first of all, that humanity is organized in such a way psychically, the human being is organized in such a way psychically that we have had to go to the worst case scenario for our species before we could break into the secret of our divine experiment. This is not going to end in a nightmare. This is not going to end in a doomsday scenario. But we had to go to the point where it would almost be so, where that threat would actually be looming on the horizon in order to be in enough shock to be woken up. Mm. You know, Kali, who rules over this period of time, which is exceptional degeneration and exceptional advance, is the shock goddess. She awakens us by shock. And so we have to be shocked by the prospect of a nightmare of our own making in order to wake up and seize the true potential for this divine experiment. So that's another factor that's leading us to this moment. And then there's the third factor. And the third factor is Gaia herself. The living, animating, sublime, indwelling consciousness of this planet is like the consciousness of an animal. She's an animal. Think of Gaia as an animal. You know, Gaia is a name taken from science, from the Gaia hypothesis of Lynn Margulis and James Lovelock. Mm. And I've talked a lot about the Gaia hypothesis in my book, Not in His Image, because it's very compatible with the Gnostic vision of Sophia. Therefore, I coined this joint term, Gaia-Sophia, to bring those two things together. Now, I want to point out that it would be a very good practice from here on, as well as thinking of the planet as a superorganism, which is what Lynn Margulis calls it, as well as realizing that the planet is alive, it's in a living being, it's not a dead lump of matter. Think of it as an animal. And I call that animal Pam. You can call her Pam if you want to. PAM, Planetary Animal Mother.
Right.
So call her Pam.
Pamela, Pam for short, yeah?
Yeah, Pam for short, right? Yeah. Call her Pam. Pam is waking up. Now, Pam is like a big, big lion. She's a very ferocious animal, very protective of her progeny. And this is the moment when Gaia awakens. That's why I called my framework for planetary tantra, the terma of Gaia awakening. This is the moment when she awakens. And when she awakens to the plight of humanity, and we, humanity, awaken to our plight, and then to her presence as a living divine animal, then it's a whole new game. That is the shift. And the shift is now. I'm not talking, Henrik, about things that are going to happen here. In this whole interview, I'm not talking about things that are going to happen. I do not predict. I'm talking about what is happening. This is happening now. She is awakening, and she is making her awakened presence available to every single human being who can bring themselves to it. And planetary tantra is, and it's a very simple practice. It's not complicated. It's not hierarchical. It's not a new religion. It's not a cult. I'm not trying to start a cult. Planetary Tantra is the simple practice by which each individual can bring themselves to her living presence and make this connection one person at a time. And this is the great opportunity that is now unfolding.
Is this a window of opportunity, or is it kind of from now on and forward as we go?
It is a window that is open from now on. It's not a window that's going to close. It's like an aperture, Henrik. Mm. It's like the aperture of a lens opening to a portal for humanity to enter. And in that portal is the meeting with the goddess and the interactivity with the earth and the continuation, the restoration of the divine experiment according to her terms. Because she is a divine being who conceived the human species. This is what the Gnostic myth says. And so she also conceived a certain experiment for us. And when we can interact actually with her intelligence and know what that is, then we are really on the proper path for our species.
So we, humanity, are the progeny that you talked about earlier. Her protective tendencies, if you will, then are for us, John.
Well, for all species, she has a fiercely protective sense for all the living species of the earth. And she, you know, if she sees them endangered, she will respond. But there is a particular role that we play. You know, I've kind of taken a chance in my latest writings on metahistory or to say, well, let's call ourselves her pet species, okay? I've taken a chance. I just want to play with that. Don't take it too seriously, but I want to qualify that it doesn't mean that humanity, being the pet species of the goddess, is any better than any other of her species, whether they be beavers or bears or whales or beetles. But it means that we have some exceptional role in her dream, in her eonic divine plan for an experiment. We play some exceptional role. And so her protective tendencies are certainly very strong in regard to the human species. And she's coming out with measures to protect us. And these are not things I've invented. These are things that I can describe and everyone can verify them by their own experiences.
We do hold a different consciousness, obviously, than the animals do in one way or another. I mean, we could even see it when we look around. If nothing else, John, we can definitely see it because of our disconnection to many of the things, unlike most of the animals and in nature. There's a whole different set of connectivity, if you will. But we can see through simple observation that we are separate or different from that.
Yeah, the disconnection is a disadvantage or a risk that we face because we carry exceptional faculties that other animals don't carry.
Right.
You see, when Sophia, acting from the Pleuromic Center, engineered the human genome, the human genomic design, which is called the Anthropos, she conceived it as possessing certain faculties, certain capacities, which are metanoia, dianoia, nous, epinoia, other faculties like this, which are noetic capacities of our species, intellectual capacities, which other animals don't have. One of them is obviously the capacity for language and for complex symbol systems. Another marked capacity of humanity, which makes us exceptional but not superior, is that we can extrapolate and plan and model things. You know, beavers can build a dam, and that takes a certain amount of beaver genius, and it's a marvelous thing, but we can build fantastic bridges. And in order to build a fantastic bridge, which beavers couldn't build, we have to preconceive that bridge and preconceive the steps of constructing it, right?
That's right.
Well, that is one of the gifts of our species. It's called modeling and then putting into application what we've modeled. But the problem with that, there's also a great drawback with that. And that is that we can model things and simulate things and get more interested in modeling than in reality. And we can get lost in our concepts and in our simulations. And the Gnostics warned about that, because when we get lost in our models and our simulations, when we get lost in playing with the tools rather than in using them, we become subject to this archontic deviance, and that's when we really go off the track. So in a way, one of our highest gifts, which is language and symbol making and modeling, is also carries certain risks that other animals don't yet.
That's right. It's the curse and the gift all kind of wrapped into one. Would this also explain, you think, aspects like, you know, our collective neurosis, our sense of trauma, hysteria, and even schizophrenia that mankind seem to suffer from, John?
Well, yeah, the basis of that largely is that when we make models, and when we make culture, and when we construct things abstractly, and we construct language systems, and we use codes, we become so fascinated with these that it subtly, over a period of time, takes our attention away from our source, which is nature. You know, no matter what models we can build, there is no model superior to the models of nature itself.
That's right. I mean, all our inspiration comes from nature pretty much when it comes to
it should, but unfortunately, a lot of it leads us away from nature into a self-referential maze of our own thinking and of our own abstraction. And when that happens, we do become insecure, paranoid, and erotic because we have lost contact with our source. We've lost contact with the source of life, which is the planet, not just the physical planet, but the living and divine intelligence of the planet. Mm. And so we've lost our way and we wander into narcissism and then we wander into psychosis. And this is basically where we go. We can't go much further in that direction.
That's right. So how do we tie this together a little bit John? The concept here, obviously. Oh, wait, there was one more thing I want to ask you about, actually.
Sure.
It had to do with the mythology, if you will, then, of the Sophia myth. Why
sure.
basically was left open-ended, and if that was for a reason, because that obviously makes it very different than other mythologies out there. You could even argue that it falls into a different category than a mythology, then, in one sense.
Oh, it's not only in a different category, it's incomparable. The Sophia myth is incomparable for two reasons, and I've often pointed this out. First of all, because it is the only complete, coherent myth we have that describes our origin as a human species and the evolution of the earth, the conditions of the solar system, and many, many other things. It is the myth for our species, just as each tribe, indigenous tribes in Australia or Africa or the Arctic, each had a myth of origin for that tribe. The human species has its myth of origin, and this is it. So it's of paramount importance. And second of all, it's left open-ended, which makes it a participatory myth, technically speaking.
Mm.
And the reason why it's left open-ended by the Gnostics is, first of all, because they did not invent this myth as a mind-programming tool, as certain myths have been invented for that purpose. For instance, the myth of the Messiah, the myth of the chosen people, are toxic myths of human invention that have been introduced as mind programming tools. Absolutely on the contrary, the Sophianic myth is a mind liberating vision story. And it's left open so that we can participate in it. And also it's left open because, in fact, they didn't know how it was going to end. They set us into a story. They put us into a story. And where we are now today, when we come into the Sophia myth today, we come to the story realizing that it's reached its critical point and that we are involved in the solution of the divine Sophia. We are involved in her correction. These anomalies that we're seeing in the sky, these anomalies, astronomical anomalies, the length of the day, the setting of the sun, weird, powerful rumblings and inexplicable sounds coming from the interior of the earth, vortexes appearing in the ocean, huge vortexes appearing off in the Caribbean Ocean.
Yeah.
You know, I could name more, you could name more than I, because I think you carry them often on your news features.
That's right. Sinkholes and the spirals in the sky. And what the heck is all that about?
That's right. I'm not saying that I can explain all these anomalies, But I am suggesting that if we take the Sophia myth and we bring it right up to the current moment, and we say, okay, Sophia is a name for the divine being from the cosmic center who turned into the earth. So she is the wisdom goddess, the earth goddess, and she's alive, and she is now taking the earth on its own course in interstellar space. It's very important when we contemplate the Sophia myth to put it in an astronomical perspective, because it is an astronomical myth. It's a story about something that happened in this galaxy and how the solar system and the Earth rose. Now, we currently know, based on what science tells us, that the Earth belongs to a planetary system that is orbiting around a sun. And this entire planetary system, rather like a fleet of ships, if you will, is sailing along upstream in the third arm, of a four-armed lenticular spiral galaxy. Now, everyone can have this picture, can form this simple picture. When you form this picture, you have the actual setting of the Sophia mythos. And what is happening today with these anomalies? I'm starting to work with a group of people who are collecting observations on these anomalies. And as they send them in to me, I'm attempting to use my understanding of astronomy combined with this myth to explain what these anomalies are by way of saying, up until now, up until Sophia's correction, the planet Earth was captured in the solar system. Gnostic cosmology teaches us this. I think I've mentioned this before in our previous interview. Gnostic cosmology teaches us a remarkable fact that the planet Earth is an organic body captured in an inorganic system. None of the other planets in the solar system, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, contain organic life in large creature forms, in large animal forms. There may be microbial forms of life on those planets. They don't contain life in the form that it is on the Earth. So the picture is that the Earth is an organic body captured in this inorganic celestial mechanics. The correction of Sophia is an actual astronomical event. And I couldn't talk about it until now. You know, many people asked me when my book came out, many people who got the Sophia myth and learned it, read the 9 episodes, came to me with a question, and they said, well, John, like, what's happening in the 9th episode? We're in the 9th episode. Sophia's correction is supposed to happen, and how is that going to happen? And I didn't tell them any answer because I didn't know. And now I realize that I was acting from a deep instinct, a deep gut intuition, by not answering that question, by not even trying to answer it. Because the wonderful reality here is that the correction of Sophia can only be known in the moment it's happening. And that moment is now. And these anomalies are indications that the Earth is beginning to move as a self-propelling, self-directing material globe.
Out through the inorganic system that we're trapped in.
That's right. It doesn't mean that it's moving out of the organic system, although that's possible, the inorganic system. Want to give this picture as clearly as possible. I'm going to be very rigorously careful. Imagine again, I use this nautical metaphor. I want to talk more about it, and perhaps in the second session we can really go into it. I'm using a nautical metaphor here to help picture what's actually happening. If you imagine the solar system as a fleet of ships, and don't even think of the sun as another ship. Think of the sun as a huge eddy. It's a huge spiraling vortex or eddy. And this eddy is moving down the stream of the galactic arm. Okay? You know how when you're standing by a river or even by a little creek sometime, and you're looking at the surface of the water, you can see that there are eddies in the water.
Right.
and they travel along down the stream, and they keep their form, don't they?
They do, yeah.
Imagine that the sun is a vast eddy of plasmic, solar plasmic energy, and that the planetary system is moving around it in such a way that the whole collection draws itself into a spiral, because the solar system is not flat. The eddy is moving, and so the orbits of the planets are drawn into spirals. And that is the motion to visualize of the fleet of these planets. Now, up until now, the Earth, which is a member of this fleet of planets, has more or less followed the general laws. It has been in formation with the fleet. What it's doing now is taking its own course. And I believe that I can prove that to be so. And not only can I prove it to be so, I can show in specific detail regarding the observations that are being made as to why the sun would appear why would the sun appear to be setting more hard north? Well, that is because of a certain movement that the Earth is making independent of the whole rest of the solar system. Now, it's true that science, hard science, would say, well, this is impossible. It's impossible for the Earth to do anything other than what it can do if it's locked in the celestial mechanics of our solar system, right?
Right.
But I don't care about science if it doesn't fit the evidence.
That's right.
You know? And I would have to say that these anomalies that we're seeing, Henrik, I'm sure there are much more of them that are even reported to you and reported on YouTube. Many more. And I expect that we're going to see increasing anomalies. And I also expect that we are due to see staggering anomalies. Anomalies that stop people in the street and leave them with their jaw hanging open. And science will not be able to explain these anomalies within the current paradigm of astronomy. But if we follow the journey of the Earth, and I have techniques for following it and charting it, through the stars, through the intergalactic space where it's sailing, these anomalies can actually tell us what the Earth, what the mothership is doing. I call it the mothership. What the mothership is doing, how she's actually turning her course, where she's turning her course, what stars she is using to navigate by. It's down to that detail. And this is what I'm doing now in my little crew notes and in my little navigational experiment that I'm conducting with some people.
Really interesting. It's like, it reminds me of, we have an author here in Sweden called Harry Martinsson. He wrote a story called Aniora about this spaceship, basically, that people are on. And it kind of reminds me of this story a little bit. That's a wonderful story. But where is it? I'm still trying to grasp this idea of where it is going. Maybe it is not a physical location per se, but how, if it is a traveling in somewhere else, so to speak, where...
Okay, where is the Earth going? The
right.
Earth, let's say, using the nautical metaphor,
mm.
if we want to understand Sophia's correction, I'm proposing that the best tool to use is a nautical metaphor. Now, it's a very interesting metaphor. It's not just a metaphor. If I say the Earth is a mothership sailing through the starry seas, well, that's a metaphor, isn't it? I mean, if you look at the language, it's a metaphor. But as a matter of fact, that metaphor is a literal description of what the Earth is doing.
That's right.
And it's just as good as saying the Earth is a planet moving through interstellar space. Well, that's also a metaphor. Excuse me, you know? So I'm saying let's use a metaphor that we can participate in. So we're passengers on a mothership sailing through interstellar space. And on the navigational deck, which is where I stand, we can actually understand and chart the journey. For instance, how does it happen that I can say that the Earth is starting to assume its own proper self-propelled? Get that, by the way. Self-propelled. Motion, moving slightly in relation to the solar system. It's not necessarily at first going to move out of the solar system, but it's going to assume its own discernible, detectable motion within the solar system. And that is going to cause enormous astronomical and geophysical anomalies. So where is it going? We're on a journey on the mothership. She's taking her own course now, and she's going actually back home. We're all going home. What is home? Well, according to the Sophianic myth, home is the galactic center. So we're all going back to the galactic center, but we're going back on a long, slow boat to China. In other words, we don't go back by zipping right over into the galactic center. We go back by sailing up the big, big lazy river of the galactic arm. And the sun, it is said, to sail is said to move around the galactic center, as you know, the sun and solar system is said to move around the galactic center so every so many billion years. Well, try to picture this, that the sun and the earth and the planets are moving around the galactic center. And each time they make a full circle, they move a little bit more inward toward the galactic center. It's like a closing spiral. And so if you want to visualize astronomically and poetically Sophia's journey as the planet Earth, it's a journey around the galactic center, but moving more and more in and returning homeward, because she comes from the galactic center. She is the being indwelling the Earth, is an aeon or divine energy from the galactic center. And we can actually plot the way that she is moving through the stars and moving in relation to the galactic center. This can actually be plotted. And I'm showing how to do that. And by that plotting, we can understand how and why these anomalies are taking place. I'll give you one example. Okay. I realize this is very wild, but I'll give you one example. One of the first anomalies that was noticed, which I picked up myself and you have noticed also from these reports, is just in our face, is, well, the sun is not rising at the same angle anymore. It's amateur astronomers and kids of the age of 10 years old have noticed that it's rising very hard to the north. Seems to be further north than it ought to be. How can I explain that anomaly in terms of the Gaia's taking a new course? The planet is taking a new course. Well, it's my understanding that the Earth is in the galactic arm. And you know, the galactic arm, as a spiral arm, is a river of stars, but she's not sailing on top of the river of stars. She's sailing in the river of stars. And sometimes she can go deeper in the river of stars. That is, she can go down, and sometimes she can go up in the river of stars. Do you follow that picture?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Okay. It's my understanding that in taking her new course, Gaia is using the star Canopus, which is in the constellation of Argo in the southern hemisphere. It's the second brightest star in the sky after Sirius. That she is using the star Canopus as a sort of a lighthouse or sighting point to set her new course. And the star Canopus is deep in the southern skies. And so if she is setting a course, you can imagine that she is, in a sense, dipping slightly down into the southern skies, dipping slightly into the star stream. And the result of that would be to make the north, the rising of the sun, appear further to the north, because she's dipping to the south. It would make the axial orientation to the north appear more extreme. It doesn't really change, but it appears to, and the appearance of the anomaly is real. That's the amazing thing. Can observe it. You can't explain it by ordinary astronomy. So that's one example. Now, I don't know how that comes across.
Well, let me, as a you know, furtherance point to that, let me just read you a little bit here, John, because I'm recalling this in terms of planets here out in space. June 29, 2001. Astronomers using NASA's Hubble Space Telescope have spotted something extraordinary. Apparently, there are planet-sized objects wandering through a distant globular cluster of stars. Unlike the planets in our own solar system, however, these objects are loners. They have no central star of their own. Because of the findings are so surprising, researchers caution that they must be confirmed by follow-up observations. But if this discovery is verified, it could change the way astronomers think about stars and planets and how the two are related. And then we zoom forward here into 2011.
Listen, I'm so happy that you read that, because I also came across that article. And let's put it this way. When I first started teaching the Sophia myth and sharing this fantastic story, I said that it was about astronomy, and literally about astronomy and the Earth, and I brought up the outrageous point that the Earth is an organic body captured in a planetary system. And at the time I brought that up, I shook my head, you know. Mm. And I said, gosh, nobody's going to believe me. This is just too outrageous. Well, here you go. Now science says that there can be such thing as free-floating planets. So if there can be free-floating planets in the spiral arms of the galaxy, then there can be a possible scenario of a free-floating planet being captured into a planetary system.
Absolutely.
And that's right. And if the Gnostic seers were right, and I strongly believe they were, because they worked in teams and they were trained clairvoyants and trained observers of the universe, trained shamans, if they were right, then this is actually what happened to the Earth. This is actually how our solar system came about. And one of the lines that is you find in the Gospel of Philip of Nag Hammadi says, the world as we know it, that is to say, the world system we inhabit, came about by a mistake, or anomu, an anomaly. Hmm. What is that anomaly? The anomaly is that the Earth is a profoundly alive organic planet captured in a more or less inorganic system. So there you go. That is a kind of confirmation. And not only that, but I would point out that the very fact that scientists have been able to observe these new remarkable mist clouds and these new these free-floating planets is due to the fact that the planet Earth is slightly breaking away into its own course. And as it does so, it's going to move in a way that takes it out of the paradigm of the solar system. It's going to take, and the paradigm of the solar system has a kind of control on our perception. The paradigm of the solar system, of the planetary spheres, is an archontic matrix. We don't really live in that archontic matrix, but we can be captured in it. And as we break out of the archontic matrix, we're going to see fantastic things in the cosmic environment. It's like a journey where suddenly we're standing on the deck of the great ocean liner, we're getting up out of the cabins, we're putting away our magazines, turning off our telephones, turning off our iPads, getting up on the deck. And look at what we're seeing. Look at the islands that we're passing. Look at the shipwrecks over here on the right and the left. Look at all these fantastic things, because we are actually on a voyage with her, and the entire perception of the human species of its place on Earth can rapidly and radically change as this voyage proceeds.
It's really interesting too, because I wanted to bring up that point, John, about the fact that the first story I read there was back from 2001, and they were looking for confirmation. And then just fast forwarding slightly here into 2011, as recently as May 18th, when the scientists have now confirmed this phenomena and actually estimate that there could be as many as 400 billion wandering planets in the Milky Way alone.
There you go, in the Milky Way alone. And we are in the Milky Way. The Milky Way is the name we give to the visible edge of the spiral arm where the solar system is embedded. The visible edge of it. It's not the entire spiral arm. It's only about 3% of it. Now, just imagine what we don't see in the spiral arm, if we only see 3% of it with the naked eye. And so science will be discovering things as Gaia corrects her course, as the mothership takes her own course in interstellar space. And we, as people standing on the deck, as passengers and crew, are actually going to be seeing these things. And there's nothing to be afraid of. It's not about planets and comets going to come and crash onto the Earth and destroy it. It's about awakening to a fantastic journey with the planet.
It's interesting. Then we've been looking for Planet X and, Nibiru, what have you, John, and it seems what if we are becoming it, if you know what I mean? We're becoming one of those strange planet that has either a weird, you know, orbit ourselves, or actually, you know, going to travel through other systems, if you will, much in the same way that we get stories about that we've had a visitor as well. Pretty interesting, isn't it?
I've often thought that many of the things that we're looking for and expecting from outer space are actually going to come from the Earth itself. You know, we may not be on planet X, but we're definitely on planet S, and that would be S for Sophia.
That's right. So let's just, you know, before we wrap things up for the first hour, John, because we're going to carry on talking with you, obviously, here, but okay, let's just take the hard edge scientific stuff that comes with this, if you will, then. How could we make a journey like this without a companion star to heat us up on the way? And furthermore, cosmic radiation. There are a number of things we hear about, of course, which is dangerous out there, right? In the cosmos.
That's right. That's right. Well, I want to restate the point that I just made. The Gnostics were very subtle teachers and had a profound grasp of the relationship between physical reality and mental projections of reality. They were noetic scientists of an unsurpassable level of finesse, in my opinion. And one of the things that they pointed out, one of the more difficult parts of their teaching to understand, but extremely valuable when you do understand it, is that any physical system, like the solar system, any physical or astronomical structure carries with it a mental paradigm. And if you change the mental paradigm associated with that structure, you change the structure itself. So what's happening to us is not only are there going to be astronomical and geophysical changes as the Earth assumes her own proper course in interstellar space, but there are going to be mental and psychological changes in our species. And the biggest change, which is ongoing right now, is that the entire archontic false matrix falls away. It just literally disintegrates. And part of that archontic false matrix, it has many dimensions, as you know. It's what people call the mind control system on this Earth. It's what people call prison planet. It's what people call the matrix. Okay?
Yeah.
Part of that false archontic matrix consists of scientific knowledge, which is, quite frankly, wrong and false. You know, If you look on YouTube now, you can spend 2 or 3 days, and it's very well worth it, to make an education for yourself. Go and look at the people who are telling you that Einstein was wrong and explaining how. Go and look at the people who are telling you, teaching plasma cosmology and the electric universe, who are saying that the whole idea that gravity rules the universe is completely wrong. In so many ways, I don't want to take up the time to enumerate them, but in so many ways, the accepted scientific paradigms, this is the way it is, this is the way it works, are simply wrong. And they are going to fall apart. Because at the same time that the astronomical event of correction occurs, there is an enormous correction in the human mind simultaneously. And one of the beautiful and fantastic opportunities of this correction, and let's talk about this in the second part, is the breakthrough to free energy systems.
That's right.
Yeah. We are on the threshold of the breakthrough to free energy systems. In fact, there's only one thing that stands in the way of it, and that is due to go down very fast and very hard. I'm not making predictions here. And so that free energy systems is the true dynamics of the universe. Why wouldn't it be the true dynamics of planets as well? If Gaia could realize her own ability as a free energy system, who says that she needs to be in a planetary system in order to carry on her journey? We don't know, but we can't rule out the possibility.
I've always seen the scientific field in many regards, John, as being a prominent construct of control in that sense, if you will. It has, in a tremendous, effective way, limited the way that humanity has been able to use their creativity, their imagination, think outside of the box, if you will, as well. And it seems to, we've been on this path all the time of actually limiting our knowledge. We think we end up knowing more and more about stuff, but as been showing every day, there's more and more mysteries opening up to us every day because of our observations that are, you know, in that regard, rightly so, propelled by the scientific field, us looking out into space, trying to understand gravity and what holds the particles together, etc. But at the same time, our sense of magic, our sense of wonder and fantasy, if you will, have been slashed, cut, disintegrated because of the fact that we've been limited in the way we think. And obviously, the big part of this is the indoctrination system that most people on this planet, unfortunately, goes through in their younger years and actually limit everything that has to do with imagination or possibility, basically.
Absolutely correct. You know, science, the accepted forms of science and these master theories like quantum theory, string theory, relativity, is just total crap when you really look into it. And it has really crippled our ability to actually perceive the real dynamics of the universe. And this has happened for over 150 years now. Science and physics got really off the track in the 18th century. And science basically today has become nothing but a mathematical game. Doesn't really allow us to perceive the true dynamics of the universe or nature or interact with it. But that is changing as we speak. And true science and true magic are not incompatible, you know. They're not incompatible at all. And when we get to true science, when these false paradigms like quantum theory and string theory crumble because the evidence overwhelms them, when we get to true science, we shall also be in true magic. And that is where we want to be as a species, because that is what the divine experiment offers for us. It offers for us to realize our highest capacity by an understanding of physical and natural laws to the level of magic. And you're absolutely right, Henrik. Imagination plays an enormous role in how we reach that point.
Absolutely. Let's talk more about it, John, here then, as we carry on and continue with this wonderful and very, very interesting conversation together with you, John Lash. And want to mention your website here, of course, as well, for people out there who want to check out your work and follow you more on a regular basis. You do have updates, obviously, regularly on metahistory.org. People can follow your work there. You're also the author, of course, of the excellent book Not in His Image. There's a few DVDs out there as well. I think Jay Widener did one with you back here as well, right? So tell us a bit about your website, John.
Yeah, the website is metahistory.org. It's a teaching site. It's educational. And my whole process of presenting and transmitting the Sophianic vision of the Gnostics and developing planetary tantra with people is a completely free educational nonprofit event. I don't make any money off it. I don't do seminars. I don't charge anything. And so the site is there as an open source for information. And recently, if you go to the homepage of MetaHistory, you'll also find that recently there have been 3 recorded narrations of the Sophianic vision story, the Sophia mythos. And I want to thank the people who provided those narrations, Thomas Malone, Stephanie Ainsworth, and Terry Stevenson. They're beautiful, beautiful narrations, so you can listen to the story as well as read the story. And that's on metahistory.org. Just go to the homepage and you'll find the links.
Wonderful. Metahistory.org. Do take a look. It's well worth your time. And there's tons and tons of material, as we mentioned before, on that website too. Do take a look. And of course, stay with us here then, John. We'll take a short little break and then we'll carry on in the second hour with much more of Sophia's correction.
In the second hour, we'll continue to discuss the steering mechanism of the Earth and the Moon, as the mothership continues on the journey home. We'll also explore further the ideas of the Draconian and the Archontics control matrix. John also praises the work of Dr. Judy Wood and discusses in some detail how he thinks that the real truth of 9/11 could be the solution, the key, if you will, that will unlock the prison that humanity is in. Later we discuss trimorphic protanoia, eco-fascism, and the elite's Gaia fraud, dreams, the organic light, the March 19th supermoon, and more. But we begin to talk about the anomalies and the artificial nature of our own solar system. John brings up Sulu shaman Kredomutva and the theories that the moon is artificial. So do stay with us for the second hour for a very interesting continuation. Subscribe or log in to download or stream this or any of our previous programs and other material on our website redicecreations.com. And upcoming on Red Ice Radio, we have Christopher Knight and Alan Butler, Andy Lloyd, Brian Forrester and David Hatcher Childress, Wayne Herschel, Joseph P. Farrell, Robert Bavall, Penny Pierce, Alex Putney, and many more. But right now, we'll proceed with John Lash. Do not miss this. We are discussing Sophia's correction together with John Lash, a very, very interesting conversation. We're going to get into a whole lot more now on these aspects that we've been discussing and trying to answer some of the questions, basically, of obviously what some of the effects are, what the outcome is, and obviously where we've been discussing, John, where we are going or where the planet is taking us, rather, on its journey. And a little bit later, I want to ask you more about the Archontic Matrix, because I was alluding to this idea. I wanted to ask you about the artificial moon. You know, many people have speculated that the moon alone is an artificial body, but you obviously take this a step further now when you say that the whole system we're part of is actually an artificial construct in that sense. Do you put any extra credence to the fact that the moon is in regards different, or again, is it actually the whole darn system then that is constructed in one way? Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, according to my understanding of the astronomical truth, the astronomical facts that are encoded in the Sophia myth, this is the way to understand the solar system. The Earth is an organic body, and it is actually the living embodiment of a divine being from the galactic center. She, Sophia, as she's called, wisdom, morphed herself into the planet Earth. Then the Earth becomes the habitat for many different species, including one particular species, the human species, which also was the creation of this very goddess. This is what the myth tells us. But it also says more. It says that when the goddess Sophia was in the Pleroma, before the Earth was created, before the Earth came into being, she had a vision of an experiment that she wanted to see happen. And that she envisioned the setting of that experiment as a three-body system. This is called, in the language of the Gnostic text, the trimorphic protanoia. Trimorphic means three-body, and protanoia means the primary idea. So the primary idea that the goddess herself had was she sees a three-body system, and she sees the human species appearing in that system and living out a certain experiment. And we're going to learn now, we are learning now, and in the immediate future, exactly what that experiment was and what the terms of it were. So the way that a Gnostic would view the solar system is to say that the sun, the moon, and the earth are structurally coupled. The sun, the moon, and the earth are actually all part of the Gaian system. The Gaian superorganism is the earth itself. But the total Gaian dynamic is a three-body system. And so even though the moon may not be, as far as we know, organic in supporting life, or the moon and sun are integral to the support of life. And so they are not hostile in any way or alien to life on Earth. They are actually integral to the support of the Gaian superorganism. The rest of the planets of the solar system, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, are an inorganic celestial mechanics. That is the archontic part of the system. Hmm. And the sun, moon, and earth, the three body part, is the organic part. And the organic part is where Gaia's experiment is being played out. So I would completely and absolutely disagree with David Icke and other people who are getting on the bandwagon about this artificial moon thing. Mm-hmm. The moon is not artificial. The moon appears to be artificial. It appears to be an artificially constructed and arranged satellite, because that is in fact how the Earth intelligence herself set it up. You see, she uses the moon to monitor life on Earth in certain ways. It is, in a way, her tool, her satellite. It's her biofeedback device. The moon is a biofeedback device of the living planet. It is not some artificial satellite set in place by the alien extraterrestrials. That is my view, and I stand absolutely behind that view. Also, I want to point out something just very quickly. I'm glad I have the opportunity to say this, because this is something that I find outrageous. It's an outrageous omission. You know, I like Credo Mutwa very much. I think that that Zulu or Sanusi shaman is a profound voice of the indigenous wisdom of our planet, and a very important testimony of him from his shamanic background. But I would point out that Credo Mutwa, who has worked closely with David Icke, has said, you know, there are these aliens, these predatory aliens called the Chidori, right?
Right.
Right. And he has said certain things about them. And in certain respects, those predatory aliens that he describes are very similar to the Archons that Gnostics described. But I would point out something that seems, I don't know why, I can't be the only person who's noticed this. But in his testimony of the Chidori, Credo Mutwa makes a remarkable statement. He tells about all these encounters, his own encounter, abduction encounter, which is hair-raising and gruesome. And he tells about what they do and how they were responsible for the separation of the sexes, because the original androgyne human went into these caves and then they came out and they were separated. And apparently now he's saying that there is a Zulu legend that says that the Chidori set the moon in place, okay, as an artificial satellite. But the observation that I want to point to is that Credo Mutwa says that the Chidori, E.T., Anunnaki aliens are liars and deceivers.
Right.
He says they are known to be liars and deceivers. Now, he's not the only one that says that. If you look at the comparative material, you can build up quite a case. The Gnostics said exactly the same thing about the Archonic mind parasites. They are liars and deceivers. And Michael Harner, who was a key figure in the shamanic revival of the 70s, was one of the first people to go to the Amazon and take ayahuasca. And in his ayahuasca vision, he saw an Anunnaki or Archontic type dragon figures who flew in through the sky in a kind of canoe, and they talked to him in his ayahuasca vision. And they told him, well, we created the human race. We are the dragon masters, and we seeded you on this planet and everything. And his mind was blown. And when he sobered up and he had his briefing afterwards with the old ayahuasca shaman, he said, you know, I can't believe it. I met these alien dragon-like beings, and they told me that they are our creators. And the old shaman laughed. And he said, they're liars. They tell everybody that.
Well, it's a good point. I mean, they wish, right? Why should we trust their accounts just because they
say
right. it, you know?
And so what I'm saying is, if Credo Mutwa has said that the Chidori are liars and deceivers, and this reportage or testimony is supported by other cases, and there are even others I could cite, then why does he believe the story about the moon? Why does he believe? Because that story comes from them. So, you know, I think that it's a lack of critical scrutiny is very, very serious here. The lack of critical scrutiny regarding these beings, and that they have come, they have told us that they are lords of the universe. I've pointed out that the Anunnaki script of Sitchin is a disinformation. It's a lie. Mm. It's a lie planted in the human mind to make us think that we are a slave species. The whole slave species scenario is a lie. And the first people who pointed that out were the Gnostics. And I am taking up the torch and reiterating that message.
It's a very good point, I think. And at the same time, I guess what I can kind of understand, I'm not saying that this account that they're retelling or so is not intentional in that sense, but I can also feel that from the point of view where they're coming from, if they've had such a realization, either, you know, literally, like, let's say, Kretamutva, or I guess scholarly to some degree in terms of Sitchin, then, I guess that they feel that this is at least a source which is, from their point of view, a higher source, if you know what I mean, John, and therefore it is taken literally and not run through the same critical filters that we would do with another human being, let's say.
There you go. It's not run through the critical filters. And one of the great dangers of any contact with these archontic beings, which are psychic shapeshifters who can take various forms. I believe that the Anunnaki, the Archons, and the Chidori are basically shape-shifting versions of the same mind parasites. One of the dangers is indicated by the Gnostics, who also called them the rulers and authorities. That's another translation for the name Archon. And there's a huge warning in that. Basically, don't listen to the authorities or anyone who presents themselves as an authority, especially when it's just an authority on the supernatural, you know? And so when we take them for authorities, when we go to the Sumerian tablets, and I think Sitchin's reading of them is very dubious, but let's say that they do contain this story of a genetic intervention. Well, just because something is written on clay tablets 2,500 years ago doesn't mean it's true.
That's right.
Okay? It's no more different than something written in the Wall Street Journal. Come on. You know? And so we've got to be very careful about authorities. One of the great breakthroughs that is happening right now is that the power of the authorities is being shattered by the inpouring of the Gaian mind into the human mind. What happens in Gaia's correction, which began on March 19th, 2011, if you want to put a specific date to it, and it's going to last for 3 years until March of 2014. It's going to happen very, very fast. And in this time, what will become evident, what becomes evident in many aspects of life, is that somehow it's like the veil falling off your eyes, the scales falling away from your eyes. Many people inexplicably can have the same experience that what they previously took on authority, whether it be from science or from a channeler, suddenly falls apart and some more beautiful, self-evident reality breaks in. It's going to be a breaking in to the human mind. Mm. The divine Sophia goddess is breaking in to the human mind. That is her intervention. And we can actually observe and verify how that's happening. It's not a fantasia that I'm proposing. I'm asking you to play along with me here, folks, you know, but I'm asking you to bring critical scrutiny to what you're told and look at the evidence of your experience. There is no authority greater than the evidence of your own experience.
The control of the archons, the archontic matrix that you talk about would obviously be aided quite a bit if at the outset we had the disadvantage of thinking that they were our creators. In that sense, we would automatically, on square one, if you will, be subservient to them because they made us, you know, in that sense. Why do you think, John, it is that so frequently then the communication seems to come through, you know, the ayahuasca ritual or something like that? There is usually a communication happening at those points and usually all kinds of interesting, weird and strange stories are being given to people or experiences, obviously, that they're having. But often, very, very often, they seem to be in this realm. They seem to be able to get through or communicate to human beings. And in some regard, it's almost also like many people's critical ability, the firewall, if you will, actually falls totally apart in that frame of mind. and people totally believe what they're shown or told, basically.
Well, there is a firewall, and the Gnostics also talked about this a lot. They talked about immunity to the alien presence. They didn't mean that you block out the alien presence to the extent that you deny its existence. The Gnostic seers of the mysteries were profoundly and acutely aware of the psychic extra-dimensional presence of these mind parasites. They were the first ones who observed them and left us a record of their behavior, of their modus operandi, of their two primary forms, which are the draconic or reptilian form and the neonate or embryonic form, like an aborted or premature fetus. You know, this information profiling these mind, these intruders is in the Gnostic text. So they were acutely aware of them, but they were also acutely aware of how to ward them off, dispel them, and put them in their place. And we have a very weak immunity as a species now. We have a weak immunity to psychic intrusion. The reason for that is because we are sexually very degenerate, and that we have lost, it's largely due to sexual practices, that due to a long and sad story, which I can't go into right now, but since the cults of the goddess were overthrown and since sacred sexuality was overcome and replaced by patriarchy and the rule of theocrats or men, we've had a down spiraling of the quality of sexual experience in our species. Now, when the quality of sexual experience is high, that is to say, when we have the ability to experience with each other sexually, sexual ecstasy and rapture, the freedom and joy and the bliss of sex for its own sake, not for procreative purposes, but for the beauty and pleasure of the sexual act, then we have a high psychic immunity. Good, honest, clean, voluptuous sex produces a high psychic immunity. And the pagans had that in their world. They had a healthy sexual attitude. The sick and pathological sexuality that has emerged on this planet over the last 2,000 years is, of course, due to the Abrahamic religions, to the condemnation of sex, until you get down to something as wicked as the sexual apartheid of Islam, you know? And so part of the reason why we have a very poor immunity is that. There are other reasons as well. Lack of contact with the earth, lack of having your bare feet on the earth, lack of being in nature, breathing the air and breathing the water, and lack of absorbing the natural elements of the earth also lowers our immunity to these psychic intrusions. Therefore, it's understandable that when people venture out of their normal mind frame into a psychic or supernatural journey by ayahuasca or any other influence, that they're going to be facing forces that they don't have, that they're with a weak firewall, as you put it.
Right.
But the Gnostics taught how to build up that firewall and how to ensheath yourself in a envelope of organic light by raising Kundalini. And in fact, Kundalini is the main weapon against these archonic intruders. You can actually zap them with Kundalini. It's very easy to kill archons and very easy to drive away and kill predatory ETs. I've wiped out many of them. You know, and people ought to be taught psychic self-defense in regarding to these entities, because there is a great risk that they will encounter them. But the fact that they are encountered in these altered states doesn't mean that they are masters of the universe, and doesn't mean that we can allow them to tell us things without applying critical scrutiny. Furthermore, the best foundation for critical scrutiny and the best foundation for taking a stand in relation to these entities is the Sophianic vision story, because that story explains who they are, and it tells us what their role is, it tells us what the threat they pose is, and it also tells us how to confront them and how to ward them off. This is contained in the first apocalypse of James. It's very clearly an exchange between a Gnostic teacher and his student, where the Gnostic teacher describes alien abduction, a perfect description of an alien abduction scenario. And then he says, listen, all you have to do when you stand in the presence of those beings is to tell them that you are of the race of the divine Sophia, that you know your origin, and that they are not your parents, and they will dissolve. They are powerless because they can only operate through a lie. So we're in a very desperate state with these archonic beings now, because through religious indoctrination and mind programming, as I explain and not in this image, there have been centuries of the breakdown of the human mind leading us to a pathological state where we are really, in a sense, some people are walking about possessed by these archonic parasites.
Yeah.
And who are those people? Unfortunately, they are the people who are largely in charge of our society, in charge of the military and the government. Many of them are in the entertainment business. Many of them are in the media business.
That's right.
And they are archontically infected pathological predators. And we as a species, if we want our species to survive, and if we want to have some kind of life in society worth living in on this planet, the moment has come to face those predators. And the Sophia myth also gives us a framework in which to do that. So it's an invaluable tool for orienting ourselves to this momentous shift that is now happening on the planet. There's nothing like it, really.
I don't want to spend too much time on this because we have so much else to talk about. But
sure.
The Abrahamic suppression of sex that you mentioned, I've been interested in that as well. It connects with so many other things that has to do with the Abrahamic religions and how they've gotten such incredible strong foothold. You know, the more you research it, it's incredibly prominent and you can see the way that they've spread throughout. Well, obviously Europe, you know, earlier on, and the, if you will, the invasion. I've made this point before on this recently on the program, that the invasions of countries we can see now, like Libya and Egypt and Yemen, spreading in Syria, etc.
That's just and Scandinavia being invaded by Islam.
It's true. That's just the way it is. But what I'm saying is that there's multiple layers of this, and we've a long time ago we've had the spread of Christianity up here, much in the same way as the invasions we can see today. But they were, you know, happening thousands of years ago in some cases as well.
Sure.
But this incredible spread there, and if the roots, if you will, not to maybe all, but lots of it goes back to the suppression of sex. Was this
totally does?
This an instruction that the Archons gave to the elite priest class at the time, or was this something that was a consequence of the fact that they themselves were damaged or hurt in some way? I know that that's like close to impossible to know, but what's your hunch? What's your take on that?
The one thing fed the other. You can run around like a dog chasing your tail, Henry, trying to figure out what came first.
Right.
You know?
Right.
The one thing fed the other. There was a need for men at a certain point to just as human beings, and maybe as for some reason neglected or rejected human beings, to assert their power. They needed an excuse to assert their power, so they were vulnerable to this archonic influence and to the lies that came through mainly channels, through channelers. Watch out for channelers, you know, because it's channelers in the soothsayers of the ancient Chaldean world who brought in this Anunnaki script in the first place. The Archons brought their story to our species through channelers, psychics. So I'd like to take just to address what you just said and to bring it around to something really, really important. I'd like to take, like, if I can say just about 5 minutes to do that, which is about the problem.
Yeah.
Because the Abrahamic religions is about the problem. And then I'd like, if we can steer the remainder of this, second half into the solution.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
The problem, a great deal of the problem, as the Gnostics identified it, is Abrahamic religion. And they gave us a brilliant analysis of Abrahamic religion. And one of the amazing things about their analysis is that they pointed out that it has a parapsychological origin. So according to them, the Abrahamic religion program of the chosen people, the paternal father God, who is entirely male, who the removal of the divine feminine from the creation process, the divine Messiah, Savior who comes, the glorification of suffering of the Savior, the victim-perpetrator game between Savior and saved, and the end of the world scenario, all of that, those elements were of a parapsychological or extra-human origin. They were an implant of the archontic powers into the human mind, an alien implant, as Castaneda suggested. You know, they give us their mind. There's an alien implant. And that alien implant was like a mental virus. It is a mental virus. And it had to come to humanity through a vector, like any other virus. Now, this has nothing to do with blaming the Jews, because the ancient Jewish people and the Jewish people living today, who are genuinely Jewish, not the ones who just claim to be, have nothing to do with the cause of this problem. It just so happens that it was in an ancient Jewish sect that this vector planted itself. That's the way it worked out historically. So there's a moment in history when parapsychology and exopolitics and extraterrestrial influence comes into history, into our history, and turns us away from our connection to the divine Sophia, from our connection to our own sexuality as a source of pleasure and beauty. And believe me, folks, pleasure and beauty is what it's all about as far as Sophia is concerned. If she had her way entirely, we would just live in pleasure and beauty all the time, because that is her dream for us. We get turned away from pleasure and beauty, turned away from the healing powers of our own bodies by this Abrahamic archontic virus. Okay? And as you know, I describe the history of that in quite a lot of detail in my book, Not in His Image. Now, I want to bring this right up to date now, because I want to come into the present. And one of the messages that I'd like to put out to people in this interview is that there is no more time to get involved in the problem. It's time to get involved in the solution. We've been looking at the problem for a long time, and it's a complex problem. And I have great admiration for the sleuths and detectives and investigators and researchers, like myself, who have meticulously gone back into the past and looked at the problem and tried to figure out how humanity could reach the psychotic nightmare that we appear to be in today, and how this massive mind control scheme could have been established. But I submit to you that we already know all we need to know about the problem. It's time to really concentrate on the solution. And a key factor in getting to the solution is 9/11. Really a key factor. I would say that the riddle of 9/11 is like a riddle. The event of 9/11 is like a riddle presented to humanity, that our own madness has presented us with a riddle. Our psychosis as a species, our alienation from the divine source that we're standing on and from the divine source of the pleuromic center, has driven us into a psychotic state, and that psychotic state has blown up in our face with a riddle. And we cannot get to solution unless we solve that riddle. And I just want to point out this about 9/11. We're coming around to the 10th anniversary.
Yeah.
And what I see happening, and this is just my observation, other people may agree or not, I see that there is going to be an orchestrated and manipulated attempt to absolutely crush and bury the 9/11 truth movement. And there's very devious things going on. There are people who are betraying the movement, who are probably planted there to do so in the first place. And there is going to be an attempt by the official powers to celebrate the 10th anniversary and say to the world, well, it was awful and we all agree, but we're going to go beyond it now. Let's put that behind us. And let's go on with the official version and let the authorities take care of us.
That's right.
And there, and I want to point out that one of the factors that's going, but that's not the way I see it playing out, my friends. I don't see it playing out that way at all. I see the 9/11 event exploding. And I'll tell you why I do. Because we have a fuse. We have been provided by a fuse to blow the 9/11 riddle right open, so that it blows a hole in the human psyche that we can move out of psychosis into a sane way of life. We have been provided by a fuse, and the fuse is lit and it's burning. And that fuse is the work of Dr. Judy Wood.
Right.
That's right. Now, some of you are sympathetic, and I am too, are sympathetic to the 9/11 truth movement. But I have to tell you the very sad and unfortunate news, or at least this is John Lash's opinion, that from its inception, and especially from the third or fourth year, the 9/11 truth movement became a controlled opposition and was deeply penetrated by COINTELPRO. The proof of this is in the position taken by Stephen Jones and Richard Gage regarding the work of Judy Wood. By the way that they respond to the evidence presented in her book, and the evidence is evidence, her book has more evidence about 9/11 than anything that ever written or probably ever will be. She does not speculate. She does not theorize. She presents the evidence of what we actually see there. And they will not face that evidence. That proves that they are COINTELPRO. They are part of a controlled opposition. So I would suggest that when we correct our perception about 9/11, based on the fantastic work and truly sober and scientific work of Judy Wood, we have a breakthrough toward the correction of our species, and that also leads to the breakthrough of Sophia. The two things are really, really closely related. But we have to get through 9/11. We can never put it behind us. We have to get through it. And this is how we get through it. I can tell you in one sentence. The 9/11 truth movement, which is controlled opposition, has claimed what? Oh, the official story is wrong. The buildings did not come down because they were hit by airplanes. They were brought down. Buildings came down in a controlled demolition due to thermite explosives planted in them. Right? Have you heard that before?
Oh, yeah, sure.
How many times have you heard that? Thousands of times?
So many times I've begun looking at other stuff because it's,
right.
You know, it's interesting, but, you know, there's other things out there happening
first as well. First of all, it's not true. It's just not true on the basis of, I just said, remember, what is the best authority in the world? It's the evidence of your own experience and the evidence of your own senses. It's not true to say that the official story is wrong because the buildings were actually brought down by controlled demolition, because the buildings did not fall down.
That's right.
The truth.
Right.
The buildings did not fall down. If the buildings fell down, then there would have been 110 stories of rubble.
That's right.
And there isn't. There is at most 15 to 20%, absolutely most. There are maybe 12 stories of rubble. Where are the other 80 or 90 stories of rubble? Everybody saw what appeared to be the buildings falling down because of the way that the floors seemed to be removed as the buildings disappeared. But actually what happened was the buildings disappeared, and they disappeared in front of everybody's eyes. So no matter what you think about CGI cloaked missiles, you know, missiles disguised as airplanes hitting the building, which I think was the case, no matter what you think about the possibility of some thermite traces in the dust, thermite, even if it had brought down the buildings by controlled demolition, could not turn steel and concrete into dust. So Judy Wood's evidence and her case leads to one irrefutable, brilliant, clear conclusion: that the 9/11 events were done by the use of free energy devices.
Right.
That are capable of disintegrating the molecular structure of matter and turning it to dust right in front of your eyes. And if you don't believe me, look at the photographs in her book. They are photographs of the building actually turning to dust. And everyone knows that. What was all the dust? Why didn't the paper burn? She shows irrefutably that the only thing that we know of is free energy. Now I want to come back around to the solution. And I want to pick up a point that we made in the first hour. In order for us now as individuals and as a society to realize this fantastic opportunity of Sophia's correction, to realize that it's an opportunity and what kind of an opportunity it is, we can take the riddle of 9/11. The way that we deal with this event is a key to taking responsibility for life on Earth, to taking responsibility for the future. And I think it's absolutely clear to anyone, scientist or non-scientist, that the inference of Dr. Judy Wood's work, the inference of her work is that these devices already exist. This means that some human beings have the knowledge of free energy physics. They know the laws, the principles. They know how to construct these devices. But it so happens, unfortunately, that those people are using them as a weapon against the rest of the human race, and that they are genocidically insane. That is the worst possible thing that could happen on this planet. And only by facing 9/11 can we deal with it, not by putting it behind us, not by forgetting about it, not by being appeased by the authorities who are now going to try to bury it and entomb it.
Yeah.
And not by being tricked by the COINTELPRO controlled opposition.
Well, I mean, John, let's face it, everything on a geopolitical scale that consequently has happened in the last 10 years is because, that we hear from their point of view, because of 9/11. How can we forget it? How can forget these trillions, whatever it is, of dollars and all the rest of it, NATO getting involved, European countries involved in these wars? I mean, it's forgetting about it? Forget about that. You know, no way.
And we may as well give up and say we have no control and we have no responsibility for correcting what has gone wrong in human society. And I'm saying no way. It's not going to go away in September 2011, which is a new 9/11.
Yeah.
I see the possibility and the opportunity for the breakthrough that 9/11 really presents. And that is where we come around to the solution. First of all, I urge everyone to read the Not in His Image and to read the story in the first six chapters about the rise of the Zadokim sect of the ancient Hebrews. The Zadokim sect was the religious fanatics of the Dead Sea, and they carried the archonic virus that is now mutated into a global pathology. None of the secrecy and manipulation and deception that we see in a mass scale on this planet could happen if that infection had not taken place. And that infection has to be lanced like an abscess. And it may not be a pretty thing to do, but when that infection is lanced and when the source of that infection is identified, then the great healing of humanity can occur. And that is now. That is right now. That's not in the future. And the Gnostics pointed out, if you want to know who has those devices, okay? You and I are having this conversation. People are listening to this. And as they listen to it, whether this week, next week, or next month, at the very moment you're listening to this, somebody has those devices. Who are they?
Yeah.
The Gnostics gave us an idea of who they are. Do you realize that?
Can I just ask you quick, John? Do you think that the 9/11 event was orchestrated from an archontic consciousness, if you will, that the plan, because you can analyze it from different points of view, and in some regards it seems to be a very shoddy, very poorly executed event. On another level, if you study certain things within the event that happened, it seems beyond brilliance, you know, the surrounding events, the fact that recently I put up on the website the fact what these children were chanting in the classroom where Bush was sitting reading the story of the goat upside down, the book there.
Right.
Kite, hit, steal, plane, must, you know. Like,
right.
What the hell is going on there? It seems like it's something else. It's a dark ritual that was performed, and it seems that it must come from a different kind of consciousness.
It's not a dark orchestrated ritual, I don't believe. One of the things that we need to be very careful about regarding both the archontic powers and the archontically infected human beings, that is the predators, the interspecies predators and psychopaths who are running around on this planet, we need to approach them both with great vigor, with great, first of all, great courage that they can be defeated. But we need not to over attribute to them. I strongly believe, and I would have to get, you'd have to have another interview with me, perhaps for me to make a convincing case of it. But I'm really of the view that there's a large tendency among certain people who are exposing the New World Order mind programming orchestration to over attribute it. To say that these psychopaths have these satanic rituals and they do it. No, they're just like serial killers. They like to do things ritualistically, but as a matter of fact, what makes the whole thing so dangerous is not their magical power, but it's the contagion of confusion. In the contagion of confusion, we all become suggestible.
That's right.
And in that contagion of confusion, that is like the cloud of confusion and deception around these beings, is that we unwittingly start to manufacture things in our minds that contribute in a way to the magic that they are trying to perpetrate on us.
Yeah. Interesting.
And we must be very skillful to avoid that danger. And one of the best ways to get out of that danger is to read what the Gnostics said about the people who are today the heirs and final heirs of the original vector of the Archontic virus. Because it is the people who are the heirs of that vector who have these weapons and intend to use them against humanity and wipe out the human race. But I have to point out that they are insane. And one of the reasons why I'm strongly urging now that we spend less time on the solution, less time on the problem and more time on the solution,
right,
is that there's a huge risk in going into the solution and going down one rabbit hole after another. Because as a matter of fact, if you're playing chess with a psychotically insane person, you will never be able to understand their moves.
Good point.
Yeah. And it's very dangerous for us to, the Gnostics warned in crystal clear language. They told us the MO of the Archons, Heinrich. And the MO of the Archons is the MO of the Zadokim cult. And it is the MO of the people today who have these weapons. And that is, it is a plan of absurdity and senselessness. It's a plan, but it's absurd.
They will throw anything at us to keep us occupied with the things that they consider to be, well, it doesn't really matter, actually, at the end of the day, whatever they consider to be what we should spend our time on or not. Another aspect to the magical, the ritual that you mentioned in that sense, that keep us confused or busy or occupied with whatever little, thing that they've created for us to obsess about in one sense.
I would suggest this point as a point of warning. If you want to investigate the planetary predators and the people who are perpetrating lies, deception, and manipulation that is throwing our world into chaos, go ahead. But bear in mind that, use the analogy, watch the film Manhunt, which is the prequel to The Silence of the Lambs. Rent that film, Manhunt, and watch that film. And it shows you how the detective who is tracking down a serial killer almost goes insane.
Yeah.
Because he has to put himself in the mindset of the serious killer in order to catch it.
That's right.
Now, that's a very dangerous game. And the serial killer knows that. Serial killers love to play with codes. They love to lay down rituals. They love to lay down a trail of breadcrumbs. Because while you're walking along and sniffing along the trail of breadcrumbs and figuring out the latest code that they use, they're perpetrating more crimes. And so I warn all of you who want to track down and expose these criminals and these perpetrators, do not get involved in that, because you won't reach the goal. It only is to their advantage. It's time to turn to the solution. And the solution is twofold, as presented by the challenge of 9/11. One responsibility is to recognize and face the facts that those buildings did not fall, that they were turned to dust by free energy devices. The inference, therefore, is that free energy devices exist, and this is the moment for our civilization to claim that technology and find it and bring it out. Because with a free energy technology in this world, we're not going to have a perfect world. We're never going to have a society. There will be conflicts. There will be differences.
Sure.
But we will have a much fairer world. and we will have a fair chance to create a cooperative and compassionate society of mutual aid. And that is in line with Sophia's vision for our experiment. Sophia is an aeon from the divine Pleroma. And I can tell you that when we come to understand the physics of the galaxy we're in, the relation of the core of the Pleroma to the galactic arms, in that understanding is the recognition that the Pleroma and the galaxy we're in is a free energy system. We live in a free energy system. True physics is a free energy system. And those parts of the physical world that don't appear to be are just exceptions to the general rule. So the beauty of the universe is that it is by and large founded on a free energy physics. And Sophia, being a divine being, being an instrument herself of divine intelligence, wants her pet species to discover that magic, that it is withheld from us, and that it is used by a tiny fragment of genocidal maniacs is what is the great crime that we must face. And that is why 9/11 is the turning point and cannot be forgotten.
John, I mean, it's also interesting how they've turned this on its head. I mean, energy, I've also argued this, energy is everywhere in the cosmos. It's everywhere around us. It's an abundance, yet
that's right.
Here on this planet, we're basically at this point now being asked to shut down our society and you know, put on a sweater if it's cold because Gaia is dying, right?
It's a complete fraud. Yeah, and I also want to point out that this term, ecofascism, which is a very good term, ecofascism is the false plea to Gaia and save the Earth.
Yeah.
What's his name? Al Gore, Maurice Strong, all those people are accessory to this madness in their own way. And they are promoting a complete hoax. It's a complete hoax. And it's only a pretext. They don't care about the Earth. They don't know Gaia. They don't love the Earth. And it's just a hoax for stealing and controlling the resources of the world.
That's right.
And it is time to face this frontally. Frontally. And with the evidence that Judy Wood presents, I think that there is a fantastic opportunity to find the real truth of the 9/11 truth movement. Let the controlled opposition fall away. And let the real truth emerge. And let people ask themselves and each other and ask their governments, you know, well, if our scientists are so brilliant and our engineers are so wonderful, then how come they're not presenting our society with free energy systems, since we know they exist because they were used to bring down.
Yeah.
They were used to destroy those towers.
That's right.
This is where we go. So it's a great breakthrough. So the breakthrough comes from us, but the breakthrough is also coming from Gaia Sophia. And I'd like to wind up our talk on a more positive note by telling about how that's coming about,
right,
if I may.
Yeah, absolutely. Go ahead.
Well, you know, as I said, Henrik, I restored the Gnostic myth, the Gaia mythos, if you will, and I called it the scenario of the fallen goddess scenario, because that's what it was typically called. Fallen goddess means that a powerful entity, a divine being in the galactic center, fell out of the galactic center, which the aeons or inhabiting gods of the galactic center normally don't do, and fell into the realm of physics and materiality of the galactic limbs and got involved in planetary evolution. And that is the story of our Pam, the planetary animal mother. And when I told that story, I retold it in 9 episodes, I ended up and I said the 9th episode is the moment of Gaia's correction. Gnostics didn't say what that was, but we're going to find out when it happens. And I left it open. And then people wrote me and they said, oh, things are so bad. You know, the Sophia story is so beautiful. And if she's here, if she is alive, if she is aware, then is she going to do something? You know, what's she going to do, John? Is she going to intervene? You know, what's going to happen? And it's sort of like that moment in Avatar. Remember when Jake turns to Netiri. And, you know, the military industrial complex is coming, right? Mm. They're coming with their flotilla of spaceships and all their heavy arms, right? And they're going to destroy the natural habitat of the Pandorans, right?
Right.
And Jake says, you know, oh my God, Netiri, what are we going to do? Let's go to Awa, who is the avatar equivalent of Gaia, okay, the mother goddess. Let's go to Awa and ask her to help. You know, doesn't she intervene? And Netiri says, she only intervenes to restore the balance of life. That's a beautiful, beautiful line. You know, whatever else you may say about that film or James Cameron, that is a very inspired line. And so Gaia Sophia is now intervening. She's intervening in a way that I couldn't say before because I couldn't know what it was until it was happening. I couldn't predict it. I couldn't invent it. I couldn't second guess it. And the message that I'm giving to the people who are now working with me on this, on the deck of the mothership following the navigation, the message that I'm giving is we come into correction with Gaia in real time. And this is real time. And what is happening in real time? A number of things. First of all, I see now what she's doing. I see now how she's going to make her intervention. And she's making it on several fronts, but primarily she's going to make it by actually breaking into the human mind. Not going to, she is. Try to think of a supernatural power breaking into the human mind rather in the way that a wave of surf would break through a plate glass window into a room. She's breaking into the human mind. And how does she then reveal her presence to us and say, in effect, speak to our hearts and speak to our minds? She does it through the awesome power of her beauty. Beauty is her weapon. Beauty is the most powerful weapon of the Earth Goddess. And her beauty is breaking into the human mind with correction. And this started in March, on the 19th of March, and is continuing with an accelerating and amplifying move. And as the beauty of the Divine Sophia breaks into human imagination, it produces spontaneous spiritual experiences, spontaneous awakenings in all kinds of people all around the world in different moments. And these awakenings can happen in a dream. People have been reporting to me dreams, and typically the dream will involve white, a white woman, a woman in a white robe, a white animal, or just white clouds, because white is the color of the organic light. It has nothing to do with racial white or black.
Sure.
It happens to be the color of the organic light. And so this breakthrough is happening in a general sense with the beauty of Gaia coming to recognition in people's minds. And it's happening in a specific sense in a remarkable ways. For instance, on the 19th, she made her first hit on the human psyche. She's hitting the human psyche, yours, mine, everybody's, with a kind of an impact that is very intentional. And the purpose of the impact, the first impact was on March 19th.
We had a supermoon.
Right. Yeah. And I can't go into it now, but in the navigational process that I'm developing on the deck of the mothership, as it were, I explain that the mechanism of the moon, which is called the line of the apsides, the barycenter, and the line where the point where the moon is closest to the earth, which is its perigee, and furthest from the earth, that mechanism is actually the steerage of the earth. Gaia uses the lunar mechanism to steer the earth in interstellar space. And I can actually demonstrate how she does this and say what way she is steering it at each particular moment. And people can observe whether this is true or not. I'm not asking anybody to believe me on faith. You can observe it. And so what happened was that the moon was at its perigee on March 19th. It was a supermoon because it was very, very close to the Earth. That happens once a month. And that is the moment when a signal went out from the interior of the Earth, which indicated that Gaia was beginning her course correction. And that signal was due to the fact that the barycenter, which is a point of mass, shared mass between the Earth and the Moon, which circulates inside the Earth, momentarily exceeded the speed of sound. And as a result of that, there were anomalous phenomena at that moment. You picked up on a number of them, as many people did. One of them was the sounds coming from these caves in Tibet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Another one was rumblings and inexplicable roarings coming from somewhere inside the Earth that were reported in Canada, in Florida, and some of these are still continuing.
England, I remember a little village in England had some weird hum, you know.
That's right. Yeah. The village in England where they're now trying to investigate where this is coming from.
Yeah.
These anomalies are due to the activation of the steerage mechanism of the Earth-Moon system. Steerage. So as she steers, and what she steers with is kind of like, imagine it like, not like a steering wheel that's round, but more like a yoke.
Like a rudder?
No, like a yoke like you use in a video game.
Right.
A control yoke, yeah. Or like the yoke on an airplane, okay?
Right.
She uses a yoke, and this yoke is actually the Earth-Moon barycenter device. One handle of the yoke is the perigee, and the other handle of the yoke is the apogee. And she actually steers because these two points are not constant. And by observing the way these two points, apogee and perigee of the moon, are moving, I can plot how she's steering the planet.
Hmm. Very interesting.
And you, who are interested, perhaps, in following that, can then make observations and compare those observations with what I say. Don't ask anybody to accept me on faith. It can be verified. This is what I've been doing now. This is what I am doing now since the process of correction began. So I just want to conclude by saying that the process of correction is not only the breaking into the human mind and imagination of an immense source of beauty, which is the presence of Sophia herself. It's not only a supernatural and metaphysical event, it is an actual astronomical event, which can be plotted, charted, and verified. That is the fantastic thing about correction. We can know that it's happening in real time. And as Sophia brings the power of her attention to the human condition and brings the power of her mind into our mind, she's not going to intervene in events. Don't look for that.
Mm.
It would be wrong to say, oh, this event, that event happened. She doesn't intervene in human events. She's going to intervene in our mindset. And one of the signs of this intervention is that the whole archontic paradigm of false science is literally going to crumble. You won't even have to take it apart. It will fall apart because the obvious falsity of it will be made apparent by these anomalies.
Mm.
That's much more convincing than a theory, you see?
Absolutely. And also, yeah. What happens here, obviously, John, is that people can basically participate in this. We should all then, to some degree or another, logically be able to go about, I guess, confirming some of these anomalies. What would you suggest that people can do? What is easy to do in terms of that, John?
It's easy to, first of all, observe the anomalies as they happen locally and perhaps collect records or reports or testimony of them off the internet or off wherever they show up, and just collect them and keep in mind what the anomalies are. And then if you want to look into my site, if you want to write me, jll@metahistory.org, I can put someone on the list of the crew. And what I send out is a periodic notes on the crew where I make my observations and comments about what is causing the anomaly relative to this nautical metaphor.
Mm.
See? I'm saying, let's accept a nautical metaphor, but this nautical metaphor, if you participate in it, will actually show you what's happening. It's not just a metaphor. It's not for interpretation. It is, as you say, for participation.
Yeah.
So the great thing about the solution of Sophia and the correction is that we can participate in it. Whereas if we go back into the problem too much, we end up participating in the problem.
It's true.
Yeah.
It's true.
And it's time. There's no more time for that. This correction is going to happen in 10 seconds of Ionic time. 10 seconds of her time. This is how fast. I have to tell you that Gaia's process is vast and fast.
And on our level, we're talking about, what do you say, about three years? Yeah.
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 3 years. That's right.
Well,
because 1 second is 108 days of our time.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah.
Wow. How about that, John? that's a pretty interesting ride we're up for here, then, in that sense. One more thing I was thinking about, John, before we, you know, begin to wrap things up for this time, is I think we're back into this idea of it's pretty much impossible for us to plot this, or for you to fully maybe grasp exactly how this is going to unfold and so forth. But the journey that potentially then Sophia is taking us on towards the center of the galaxy that you mentioned before, is that on a timeline as well? How are we going to travel for thousands of years? What were ideas?
Yes, I call it the journey of living eternity. And the correction that starts now is an eternal journey. And our participation in it as human beings becomes an eternal witnessing and an eternal interaction. And actually, the secret and the beauty of everlasting life comes to be revealed in the process of this journey. And so I'd like to leave everyone with a name, a title for the Sophia myth. As I said, in its received form from the Gnostics, it's called the Fallen Goddess Scenario, and it has 9 episodes. But when the moment of correction comes, which is now, and we have that magnificent opportunity, the story changes. I'm not calling it the Fallen Goddess Scenario anymore. I've given another name to the present and future part of this story. And I call it Wisdom's Dare. Wisdom is the word Sophia. Wisdom is the name of this goddess. She is wisdom. She is not only the wisdom of the earth. Look at the earth. Is it wise or not? The earth is wise. All creatures of the earth are wise. The clouds, the skies, the grass is wise. The earth is a living embodiment of divine wisdom, and we are her children as well. And so wisdom dares us to join this experiment. She dares us. And that dare comes not just from John Lash or from some words that he's speaking on this interview. It comes from her. And when you hear that dare, when you feel it, when it comes into your mind and your heart in any particular moment, that is the moment of responsibility to be a real human being in a real divine experiment. That is no fantasy, but that is what we are here for, as the purpose of our presence here on this earth. And I trust that every single human being capable of responding to her, who is not too sick from the archonic infection, can know, and absolutely know, when that dare is in front of you. So Wisdom's Dare is the name of this experiment, and the name of the story, and its ongoing and eternal aspect.
All right, John, we'll leave our listeners with that for now. And we have to have you back, obviously, sooner than rather than later, and discuss the journey. And in the meantime, metahistory.org is the website. It's been wonderful to have you back with us again, John. I really want to have you back, as I mentioned, soon again here. But people can write to you through the website. They can contact you. Obviously, again, I want to reiterate, if people want to take a look more in detail in terms of your material, your book, Not in His Image, is an excellent resource to have in everybody's library out there. Obviously, you have some DVDs that you've done together with Jay Widener. Is there anything else you want to say about the website or anything else, how people can, I guess, participate in the observations here that we've been talking about, John?
No, simply that metahistory.org is an open source learning site on the internet, and there's no commercial value attached to it at all. And everyone is welcome on board. Just write me at jll@metahistory.org if you want to get the crew notes. And this is a collaborative experiment. I will do my best using the tools that I have as a sky diviner, a processional zodiac reader, and so forth, to chart this journey, and you can verify what I say to your own satisfaction, and everyone's welcome. It's been a great privilege and a pleasure to talk with you again, Henrik.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for your time today, John.
Certainly.
We'll be back with more in just a few days. In the meantime, keep an eye on the website for the latest. My thanks to Fredrik, Lana, and Elizabeth at Red Ice, and a special thanks, as always, to you for subscribing and showing your support of our efforts. We couldn't do it without you. So thanks for listening. Have a great day. We'll talk more soon.